জনবল্লভ গিরিবর ধারি জয় গোপী জনবল্লভ গিরিবর ধারি নন্দন ব্রজ জন রঞ্জন সুদানন্দন মুনতির মনচারি Krishna. So we're reading from Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela, chapter 19, verse numbers 211 to 213. Shantarase swarupa buddhe krishnaika nishthata samo man nishthata buddhe iti shri mukha gatha. Translation, we'll repeat the verse 213. So I'll just read through the other two verses. Translation by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. When one is fully attached to Krishna's lotus feet, one attains the shamatha stage. The word shamatha is derived from the word shama, therefore shantarasa, the position of neutrality, means being fully attached to the lotus feet of Krishna. This is the verdict from the mouth of the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself. This state is called self-realization. The purport, the corresponding verse from the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 3147 follows. Text 212. Samo mannishtata buddher iti shri bhagavad vachah tannishtha durghata buddher etam shantaratim vina. Translation. These are the words of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When one's intelligence is fully attached to my lotus feet, but one does not render practical service, one has attained the stage called Shantarati or Shama. Without Shantarati, attachment to Krishna is very difficult to achieve. Text 213. Samo man nishtata buddher, please repeat. Samo man nirthasht buddher dama indriya samyamaha. Titiksha dukkha sammarsho. Jivo pastha jayadrithi. Samo man nishtata buddher. Dama indriya samyamaha. Titiksha dukkha sammarsho. Jivo pastha jayadrithi. Samo man nishtata buddher dama indriya samyamaha titiksha dukkha sammarsho jivo pastha jayodhritihi. Samo man nishtata buddher dama indriya samyamaha titiksha dukkha sammarsho jivo pastha jayodhritihi. Samo man nishtata buddher dama indriya samyamaha titiksha dukkha sammarsho jivo pastha jayodhritihi. Ladies, anyone? Okay. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. Translation. The word shama or shantarasa indicates that one is attached to the lotus feet of Krishna. Dhamma means controlling the senses and not being deviated from the Lord's service. Endurance of unhappiness is titiksha, and dhriti means controlling the tongue and the genitals. Purport. This verse is from Srimad Bhagavatam 11.19.36. The conditioned soul under the clutches of Maya, the material energy, is very much agitated by the urges of the tongue and the genitals. Control of the urges of the tongue, the belly and the genitals, which are situated in a straight line, is called dhriti. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Taramadhe jivati lobhamaya sudurmati. Among the senses, the tongue is the most formidable enemy of the conditioned soul. Urged by the tongue, one commits many sinful activities. Although Krishna has given human beings nice food, people still commit sins by killing poor animals for the satisfaction of the tongue. Not being able to control the tongue, the conditioned soul eats more than he needs. Of course, everyone must eat to keep the body fit for the Lord's service. But when one cannot control the senses, he falls victim to the dictations of the tongue and the belly. Naturally, genital agitation follows, and one seeks illicit sex. However, if one is fixed at the lotus feet of Krishna, he can control the tongue. Bhaktivinoda Thakur further states, Krishna bodo dayamoy koribare jivajoy swaprasadanna dilobhai. In order to conquer the tongue, Krishna has been very merciful and has given us nice food that has been offered to him. When a person is attached to Krishna's lotus feet, he does not eat anything not offered to Krishna. Sayinnam ritapkhao Radha Krishna gunagao Preme dako Chaitanya nitai. Since a devotee eats only prasadam, he conquers the dictations of the tongue, belly and genitals. One can control the dictates of the senses when situated in the position of Shantarasa. Then one's advancement in Krishna consciousness is assured. Om Jnanti Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Namam Vishnupadaya Krishna Parishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatharine Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. So this is a very beautiful verse spoken by Lord Krishna himself. I would like to spend a little bit of time on the previous two verses and then move on to the 2.1.3. So in 2.11, Shantarase Swarupa Buddhe Krishnaika Nishtata Shamoman Nishtata Buddhe Iti Shri Mukha Gatha Shantarase. So the discussion of this chapter, where we are at the moment, is this is a conversation of Lord Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with Rupa Goswami, where Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is explaining the ingredients of nectarian mellow or bhakti rasa. Bhaktivinoda Thakur calls it bhakti rasa samagri, which literally means ingredients of bhakti rasa. And it is this conversation which becomes the basis of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So where we are at the moment is description of Shantarasa. And Shantarasa is defined by Mahaprabhu as Shantarase Swarupa Buddhe Krishnaika Nishtata. Swarupa Buddhe, which means that one understands, when one reaches Shantarasa, one understands one's eternal spiritual position. And what is that position? As a servant of the servant of Krishna. So one's Swarupa is that one is eternally connected to the Lord and eternally maintained by the Lord and hence eternally indebted and in service to the Lord. Krishnaika Nishtata. Nishtata means firm faith. Krishna Eka. Nishtha, the firm faith is only on Krishna, nobody else. This is the basis of Shantaras. And then to substantiate what Mahaprabhu says, Mahaprabhu substantiates with evidence. And the evidence is evidence from the Srimad Bhagavatam. So he says, Shamo man nishtata buddhe iti shri mukha gatha. Shri Mukha Gatha means these are the words of Lord Krishna himself. What are the words? Shamo man nishtata buddhe. And so we go to the next verse where the same thing is quoted in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu by Rupa Goswami. So the verse from Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is Shamo man nishtata buddhe iti shri bhagavad vachaha. Shama means mana nishtata buddhe, intelligence which is fixed on me. The meaning of shama is intelligence that is fixed on me. Iti, this, Shri Bhagavataha of Bhagwan or Shri Bhagavad Vachaha. These are words of भगवान हिमसेल्फ। तन निष्ठा दुर्घटा बुद्धे एताम शांतरतिम विना। नाउ व्हाई इज द एम्फेसिस ऑन द वर्ड शमा? वी आर डिस्कसिंग शांतरस, सो व्हाई इज द एम्फेसिस ऑन द वर्ड शमा? बिकॉज द वर्ड शांत इन द संस्कृत लैंग्वेज derives from the root shama, and shama Panini defines shama as shama upashamane, which means to control or to calm or to become peaceful. So that is why the definition of shama is given in this verse, shamo man nishtata buddhe. And then going on to the next verse, the actual verse of Srimad Bhagavatam is quoted, which is 213. Which is, 213. Shamo man nishtata buddher damo indriya samyamaha titiksha dukkha sammarsho jivo upastha jaya dhritihi. So this verse occurs in the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, where Uddhava is asking Lord Krishna a series of questions, and he says, can you please define these for me? And in reply, the Lord gives the most beautiful definitions, which are all one-liners. All the definitions are just one line. So in this verse, there are four definitions given. These four things were asked by Uddhava. Uddhava asked many things, over 20 things, 20 different things. And Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur in his commentary, he writes, these are definitions according to Krishna. One may have one's own definition of these. So shama means peace. So what is the definition of peace? So everyone may have their own definition of peace. However, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says, this definition is Krishna's definition. And these are applicable to the sadhakas, everyone who is practicing devotional service. So these are specific to, applied to all of us. So the first line, Shamaha. So actually the verse 11:19:28, where Uddhava asks Krishna, he asks a question, Kaha Shamaha? What is Shama? Definition of Shama. And Krishna in reply, he replies the first line. He says, Shamo man nishtata buddhe. Peace means the person is attached to me. That is peace. This is Krishna's definition of peace. What is Krishna's definition of peace? That one is attached to him. So why is that? Why is this definition applicable? How is it definition of peace? Generally, what is the definition of peace? No war. Yeah, the opposite of war is peace, so no war. But Krishna says, Shama means man nishthata buddhe. So why? Faith in me, when your intelligence is completely fixed on me, that is peace. Because one whose intelligence is completely fixed on the Lord has no other external material motivation. See, the cause of being non-peaceful is because there is an inherent internal war in the heart. And the war is to acquire, to get things. And when that war is completely not existing because one is attached to the lotus feet of the Lord, then there is no question of having any spriha, any desires. That is why the Vaishnavas are called, there are some very beautiful words for Vaishnava. Nishpriha, those who do not have any desires other than Krishna. Another, very commonly in Srimad Bhagavatam we find the name for a Vaishnava is Akinchana. Kinchana means to have something you have, something you possess, that is kinchana. Akinchana means he possesses nothing, he wants nothing, he desires nothing other than the lotus feet of the Lord. And that is what makes the person completely peaceful. So that is shama. And dama means control. What is the highest form of control? Control of the mind and the senses. So Krishna's definition is the same. Dama indriya samyamaha. If one cannot control one's senses, no matter how large, you know, land and wealth one possesses, there will be never satisfaction. So the highest thing to control, dama, is indriya samyamaha. Krishna's definition is, these are all two word definitions, very beautiful. Titiksha means to endure, or to tolerate. So what is the highest tolerance? Dukkha. Everyone gets dukkha. Like the changing of season, like winter comes after summer, one may be elated in the summer and be completely depressed in the winter. But we have to go through the winter nonetheless. So, titiksha means dukkha sammarsho. Sammarsha means endure. Go on, carry on. So, dukkha sammarsha is titiksha. That is definition of titiksha. And what is the definition of dhritihi? Dhritihi literally means to be steadfast, to be fixed. What is the definition of one who is fixed, who is steadfast? Jivha upastha jayaha. Jayaha means to win. Jivha means the tongue. Upastha. Upastha means below. Whatever is below the tongue, you control. What is below the tongue? The belly and the genitals. So, as Srila Prabhupada says in the purport, control of the urges of the tongue, the belly and the genitals, which are situated in a straight line, is called dhriti. So dhriti is control. Sorry, steadfastness. So these are the definitions that Krishna gives. Now, I would like to go back to ask a few questions. And hopefully I'll get some answers from some of the audience. So the description that we are going through at the moment is about Shantarasa. So please tell me, from whatever we have learned or heard, what is the meaning of Shantarasa? What is the main underlying meaning of Shantarasa?
Neutrality.
So if you have a yogi who is completely unaffected, he is meditating on Vishwarupa, and he is completely unaffected by the things of the world, is that yogi a person in Shantarasa? Yes or no? No? Why not? Why is the yogi not in Shantarasa? Yes, very good. Because he is not meditating on Krishna. So Shantarasa is characterized by meditation on the lotus feet of the Lord. So the fact that one is detached from the world is in itself not categorized as Shantarasa. Shantarasa is only when one is detached from the world and one is also attached to the Lord. Or in fact, one's Trishna. Trishna means thirst. One has no thirst. One craves for nothing other than Krishna. Then the person is considered to be on Shantarasa platform. Such a high platform. One craves for nothing other than Krishna. So Mahaprabhu himself gives the definition another place in Chaitanya Charitamrita. He says, Krishna vina trishna tyaga. Krishna vina, without Krishna, trishna, any desire, any thirst, any craving, tyaga is given up. Krishna vina trishna tyaga tara karya mani. That is the only job, that is the only work. Ato eva shanta krishna bhakta eka jani. Ato eva shanta krishna bhakta. So shanta krishna bhakta is one who has no other desire other than Krishna, serving the Lord. So that is the definition of shanta bhakta. Now Srila Prabhupada, in one of the purports, he says that a shanta bhakta has, but before I go to that, I would like to ask that there are two qualities of a shanta bhakta. We just discussed two qualities of a shanta bhakta. Guna, two gunas of a shanta bhakta. And if one of those does not exist, then the person is not considered to be in shanta rasa. Those two are, Mahaprabhu gives the answer. He says, Swarga moksha krishna bhakta naraka kori mane. Swarga moksha, swarga, going to the heavenly planet, and moksha, even liberation, krishna bhakta naraka kori mane. Krishna bhakta thinks that even liberation or even the pleasure of heaven is nothing but hell, naraka. Why? Because swarga is attained through which process? Through the karma kanda. One who performs, you know, ashwamedh yajna, 100 ashwamedh yajna, then one becomes Indra. Even if one performs one ashwamedh yajna, one can still go to the demigods, kingdom of demigods, the city of Indra called Amaravati, where the Amaras live. There is one Amaravati in Maharashtra also. This is different Amaravati. So, and moksha. Moksha is attained through jnana. So karma and jnana gives swarga and moksha. Both of these results, according to a devotee in Shanta Bhakta, according to him, both of these results are nothing but naraka. Mahaprabhu says, Swarga moksha krishna bhakta naraka kori mane. Krishna nishtha trishna tyaga shantera dui gune. Two gunas. Mahaprabhu says two gunas of a shanta bhakta. What are the two gunas? Krishna nishtha and trishna tyaga. So krishna nishtha means firm faith in the Lord. Bear in mind, there is no firm faith in the service of the Lord. There is only firm faith in the supremacy of the Lord, not in the service of the Lord. Because the service only comes with dasyaras. So shantaras, there is no service. So Srila Jiva Goswami in Preeti Sandarbha, Jiva Goswami says that one who is in shantaras, he simply wants to see the Lord. He does not want to serve the Lord. He prays to the Lord. He begs for his mercy. He begs for his vision that, you know, please be visible in front of me. Please appear in front of me. But that is it. He also glorifies the Lord as supreme. But he does not desire to serve the Lord. This is Jiva Goswami's definition of distinguishing Shanta Rasa from the other rasas. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur, in his commentary on Shikshamrita, Shikshastakam, In his commentary on Shikshashtakam, what is it called? Sammodhana Vyakhya. To the commentary to please the devotees. So in that commentary, Bhaktivinoda Thakur writes that the only predominant characteristics of one who is in Shantarasa is Ullas. Ullas means elation, happiness. One is extremely pleased to see the Lord. That's it. It doesn't go beyond pleasure. It does not go beyond pleasure means it does not go to the level of serving the Lord. So these are the standard definitions. But here Mahaprabhu says two qualities. What are the two qualities? Krishna Nishtha and Trishna Tyaga. Tyaga of Trishna, Tyaga of thirst. Any thirst that one might have. And so the question might be, is the Shantarasa, is the Shantarasa superior to the other rasas, or is it inferior to other rasas, or is it the same as other rasas, and why? Anyone? In one sense, on the absolute platform, Shantarasa is the same.
Yes, but in another sense it's not, because as we all know, conjugal love is the highest expression of love.
So why is conjugal love the highest?
Because it's the most intimate.
Because it is the most intimate. So, we'll see what Mahaprabhu says. Why the other rasas are higher? First of all, the understanding of the nature of a Shanta Bhakta. What is the Swabhava, the nature of a Shanta Bhakta? The nature of a Shanta Bhakta, Mahaprabhu says, Shantera Swabhava Krishna Mamata Gandha Hina. Krishna Mamata Gandha Hina. Hina means without. Krishna Mamata Gandha. Gandha means even a fragrance, even a tinge of Krishna Mamata. The feeling that Krishna is mine is completely non-existent. That Krishna is my possession is completely non-existent in Shantaras. Shantera Swabhava. By nature, they don't have that feeling of Krishna being mine. Parama Brahma Paramatma Jnana Praveena. They are expert and fully realized in Parabrahma Paramatma Jnana. So Shantarasa Bhakta is fully realized on the platform of Paramatma and fully realized on the platform of Parabrahma, the Supreme Brahman. But Krishna Mamata Gandha Hina, which means he has no, not even a fragrance, not even a mild feeling, even a mild feeling of Krishna being mine as a possession. Whereas all the other rasas, starting from Dasya onwards, the feeling is Krishna is mine. This is a subtle difference. And from the platform of realization, from the platform of Jnana, Mahaprabhu says, Kebala Swarupa Jnana Hoya Shantarase. Only Swarupa Jnana. Only one's own self. One realizes one's own self as spirit soul. Shantarasa Bhakta realizes oneself as Anu and the Lord as Vibhu, great. Anu means minute. I am a minute spirit particle and he is the supreme spiritual being. This is the realization. So he understands his Swarupa, his position. So, kebala swarupa jnana haya shanta rase purnashwarya prabhu jnana adhika haya dasye. Purna aishwarya. So, The fact that Krishna is supreme, is that correct or not correct? It is correct. But is that complete? Is that everything in itself? Is there anything other than that that we know about Krishna or we realize about Krishna? Yes. But a Shanta Bhakta, he only realizes his minuteness versus the supremacy of the Lord and nothing else. Also, Mahaprabhu specifically says, Purnaishwarya Prabhu Jnana Adhika Haya Dasye. There is more understanding of the completeness of the glories of the Lord only from Dasya onwards. Okay? So then the question is, if Dasya, oh, there is one more actually, there is one more definition that Mahaprabhu says, how is it different? How are these rasas separated? And why is one higher than the other? And Mahaprabhu says, Gunadhikye Svadadhikye Bado Prati Rase Shantadasya Sakhya Vatsalyera Guna Madhurete Vaise. Gunadhikye Svadadhikye. So two things, there are gradations in two things. From Shantarasa onwards up to Madhurya Rasa, there are gradations. And these gradations are in two areas. In the area of guna, which means the qualities of these rasas, and swada, means how much relish one gets from these rasas. So one relishes the love of God with higher intensity in the higher rasas, whereas one's relish is lower. This is Mahaprabhu's definition. Swada. One's swada is lower. When one is in lower rasas, one's swada is a lot more intense and relishable in the higher rasas. Actually, Srila Prabhupada gives a wonderful analogy. He says, just like, you know, milk is milk. Milk is milk in all its state, if you say milk. But then there is a difference if you say milk, which has just come from the cow, the milk which has been boiled, milk which has been boiled for a long time and become thick, yeah, the cream. So all this is milk, but the intensity is more. Similarly, these rasas explain, Prabhupada explains like this, he gives the analogy of milk and boiled milk. So similarly, based on guna and swada, these two things, these rasas are graded one above the other. But then the question might be, does that mean if the Shanta Rasa is lower, does that mean that whatever qualities of Shanta Rasa exist, what are the two qualities of Shanta Rasa? Anyone? Krishna Nishtha and Trishna Tyaga. So completely unattached to the world and fully fixed in Krishna. These are the two qualities. So the question is, does the qualities of Shanta Rasa exist in the higher rasas or not? Yes. The qualities of Dasya Rasa exist in the higher rasas also. Both Shanta and Dasya exist in Vatsalya. Both, all the three, Shanta, Dasya and Sakhya, exist in Vatsalya. And all of those exist in Madhurya. So it is gradation. And Mahaprabhu gives a beautiful analogy. Mahaprabhu says, Akashadir guna jena para para bhute. Akasha, what is the quality of ether? Sound. There are five elements. Earth, water, fire, air, ether. This is Vedic metaphysics. So of these five elements, the sound, the quality of sound exists in all five. But if you say the quality of taste, does it exist in all five? No. You cannot taste sound, the ether. You cannot taste air. You cannot taste fire. But you can taste water and taste earth. So some qualities are only existing in some. But the quality of sound is existing in all five. Similarly, Mahaprabhu says the lower qualities exist in all the higher rasas. Okay, so he says, Dui tina krame bode pancha prithvite. Just like, you know, you move from akash to prithvi, you move from ether to earth. Earth is the grossest. Then water, then fire, then air, then ether. Ether is the subtlest. So you move from ether to earth, the number of qualities go on increasing. Similarly, you move from Shantarasa to Madhurya Rasa, the number of qualities go on increasing. So this is the understanding. Now I thought I would present some more technical topics, but I think it may be a little going over the board. So can I continue or?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, let me think something else. Just a pastime. So just to understand, Prabhupada actually says at one place that the Shantarasa Bhakta is between a personalist and an impersonalist, he says. Or realization of Shanta Rati is between personalism and impersonalism. What is the meaning? Impersonalism means the being one with the Supreme. And personalism means being the servant of the Lord. So Shanta Bhakta is neither a servant of the Lord, nor is he merging into the Supreme. So he's in between somewhere. But understand this, that the four Kumaras, they were Brahmavadis. Brahmavadis means they realized that the Lord is Supreme and he is Supreme Brahman. But they had no conception of the personality of Godhead. They had no conception until they actually saw the Lord in Vaikuntha. Before they saw the Lord, they had a smell of the tulasi and chandan, which was applied to the lotus feet of the Lord. And that aroma, simply with that aroma, there was a purification of the mind and the heart, and they became Shantarasa Bhakta. See, it is only at that point they become Shantarasa Bhakta. What other examples do we know of? I'm going to lighten up the subject a little bit. But what other examples do we know of Shantarasa? Sukhdev Goswami, yes. Sukhdev Goswami was a Brahmavadi. And he was Shanta Bhakta. Shantarasa Bhakta. Actually, in Adi Leela, chapter 8, in one of the purports, Srila Prabhupada says that the land of Vraja, the river Yamuna with beautiful banks, the forest, the trees, the kadamba trees, the beautiful, you know, tamal trees, the flute of the Lord, the stick which he holds, he got a beautiful stick, all of that, and in fact he also says the cows are in Shantaras. Of course, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur in one of his commentaries says that cows are in Vatsalya Ras because they give milk. And he, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that everyone has, every being in Goloka has a Ras higher than Shanta. Every being has a, but Srila Prabhupada says that. So how do we reconcile? The reconciliation is that there is never only one rasa. There is one predominant rasa. Like Yudhishthir. Yudhishthir Maharaj had a primary rasa of, what was his primary rasa? Yes, but his rasa was amongst the five rasas. Shanta rasa? Yudhishthir Maharaj? Vatsalya, was he acting with Krishna like a mother or father? Dasya. So he wanted to be protective? It means palana. The quality of Vatsalya Rasa, according to Mahaprabhu, is, in one word, palana. Palana means, I will maintain. I will protect, maintain. So even amongst the sakhas, there are three kinds. The younger sakhas, they have a sakhya dasya bhava, which means they will serve the Lord. So when Krishna is there, you know, with the gopas, the younger gopas, they will fan Krishna, they will press his feet. So they have sakhya. Sakhya bhav is there, but sakhya bhav is also mixed with dasya. Whereas then you have the Priya Narma gopas, who are his, like Stoka Krishna, yeah, or Shridama, or there are several others, Madhumangala, for example. What do they do? They treat Krishna as equal. You are just like us. You don't think of yourself as too high. In fact, you could be inferior to us. And then there are other, third category, are sakhas who are older. And they have a tinge of vatsalya. Sakhya is there, but it is tinged with vatsalya. So you are right. But however, Yudhishthira Maharaj, according to Rupa Goswami, and according to Srila Prabhupada, the Nectar of Devotion, Rupa Goswami also says in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Yudhishthira Maharaj's primary mood is dasya, mixed with a tinge of sakhya. Primary dasya, mixed with a tinge of sakhya. Whereas Arjuna is primarily sakhya. So these are the, sometimes it's not so clear to us. That's why we just go by what Srila Prabhupada is saying, or Acharya is saying. So, any other examples? Shukdev Goswami? Good example, then? Bilva Mangal Thakur, yes. You know who says that? He's in Bhaktivinoda Thakur says. Good. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, in his Jaiva Dharma, he says that Bilva Mangal Thakur is Bilva Mangalera Bhava Hoya Shanta Rupe. Bilva Mangal's Bhava is in Shanta Rasa. Who else? Shukdev Goswami, Bilva Mangal Thakur. You gave any other example? Prahlad Maharaj? In one of the purports, Srila Prabhupada in Srimad Bhagavatam, 7th canto, he says that Prahlad Maharaj is like a vatsa. Vatsa meaning a child of Narsingadev. So he's seeking protection from the father. He's in that mood. However, Brihad Bhagavatamrita Sanatana Goswami, if I come to your point, Prabhu, Sanatana Goswami says how Narad Muni first encountered Prahlad Maharaj. And he glorified Prahlad Maharaj. And Prahlad Maharaj said, well, I don't do any positive service. As in, I'm not always serving the Lord constantly. But I'm envious of Hanumanji, who is constantly serving. So one might infer that Prahlad Maharaj is in Shantaras. However, it does not say that in the text, Brihad Bhagavatamrita, but one might infer like this. Srila Prabhupada says Prahlad Maharaj is having the mood of a child seeking protection from the Lord. That is his rasa. So, predominantly dasya, servant. However, in Brihad Bhagavatamrita, if you read, I think it is 4th chapter, you will see that Narad Muni first approaches, does anyone know here, Brihad Bhagavatamrita? He first approaches Prahlad Maharaj, then Prahlad Maharaj says, no, superior than me is Hanuman, because he is always serving Ramchandra. So then he goes to Hanuman. Hanuman says, oh, I've heard that, you know, Ramchandra has appeared now as Krishna. And he is in fact a friend of the Pandavas. I am simply a servant, but he is a friend. So that's another higher. So from that is why, you know, some devotees infer that Prahlad is on Shanta, going to Hanuman on Dasya, going to Pandavas on Sakya, Sakyaras. And then Pandavas, who do they send? They say that, oh, we are friends, but you know, we are only sometimes here. But the Yadus are very fortunate because Krishna appeared there. Krishna may be our friend, but Yadus are very fortunate. Krishna appeared himself there. So you go to the Yadus. So amongst the Yadus, he goes to Uddhava. Uddhava is mix of Dasya and Vatsalya. So Uddhava is very dear to Krishna. And then Uddhava says, well, if you think that I am, you know, very intimate, then I can tell you that when I visited the gopis of Vrindavan, I was completely stunned seeing their love for the Lord. So Madhurya, so gopis, you go to the gopis. So then Narad Muni goes to the gopis, then he glorifies the gopis. I think this is an episode of Brihad Bhagavatamrita in 5 minutes. You know, this whole thing is like this, okay? So anyway, thank you for mentioning Prahlad Maharaj. Anyone else? Bilva Mangal Thakur, Prahlad Maharaj. What about Dhruva Maharaj is primarily Dasya. Nava Yogendras, you know the Nava Yogendras mentioned? They are all in Shantaras. Nava Yogendra, 11th canto, where we have this beautiful verse of Mahaprabhu's predicted, you know, in the 11th canto, is by Nava Yogendras. Who else is in Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya also? Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was on Shantaras. Again, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says this, that Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was on Shantaras. So I'll just mention a few things about Shantaras. It is very, very difficult to give up attachment for the world. For this world. Extremely difficult. So difficult that even when one is a great rishi, one cannot give up the attachment. We have the example of Jaimini Rishi. Also the four Kumaras are in Shantaras, right? So Jaimini Rishi, sorry. I just remembered four Kumaras. Jaimini Rishi, he was supposedly very, very self-controlled. And he was, you all know this pastime probably, he was learning Srimad Bhagavatam from Srila Vyasadeva. Jaimini Rishi is the author of Karma Mimamsa. Karma Mimamsa is one of the Shad Darshanas, one of the six systems of Vedic philosophy. There are six systems of theistic philosophy and six systems of atheistic philosophy are also there, like Charvaka, Bauddha, Jainas, etc. So among the theistic philosophies, one of the six philosophy is Karma Mimamsa, which is also called as Purva Mimamsa. The author of that is Jaimini Rishi. Jaimini is actually a disciple of Vyasadeva. So Jaimini Rishi was very, very powerful. So he was saying, you know, I cannot be affected by anything of the world. And Vyasadeva said, well, you are a brahmachari. You have to be always careful of, you know, interacting with the opposite gender. But Jaimini Rishi said, oh, I don't think anything will affect me. So Vyasadeva said, okay, no problem. You study Srimad Bhagavatam, I am going away for 3 months. I will come back. By that time you study Bhagavatam. So Jaimini Rishi said, yes, I will study. So Jaimini Rishi was studying. So there is a verse in Srimad Bhagavatam. And the verse is, Balavan Indriya Gramo, Balavan Indriya Gramo, Vidvamsam. Vidvamsam means even Vidvamsam apikarshati, Vidvamsam means even the greatly learned people, Balavan, very strong, Indriya Gramo, the senses are extremely strong. They attract even a man of knowledge. Even the most knowledgeable person, the most realized person, still can be attracted by the senses. So the verse is, Balavan Indriya Gramo, Vidvamsam Apikarshati. Even, api means even. So this Jaimini Rishi was reading this verse. He was saying, this is not true, you know, this cannot be. If one is realized, one is Vidvan, what is the question of the Indriya Gramaha, the various senses attracting somebody who is learned? What is the question? Cannot happen. So he changed the verse. The Bhagavatam verse, he changed. What did he do? He said, Balavan Indriya Gramo, I agree. Indriyas are very powerful, but Vidvamsam Napi Karshati Na Api. But they do not affect the learned. He wrote like this. He changed. And then Vyasadeva realized his, you know, pride. So then later on, I will just cut short because in interest of time. So when Jaimini Rishi was walking on the banks of river Ganga, he sees that there is one lady who is beautifully dressed, and she is waiting there, and suddenly the clouds gather and the rain starts pouring, and Jaimini Rishi is going to his hermitage, and he sees this lady standing there under the tree, but she is getting wet and she is shivering because it is cold. It is Margashirsha Ritu, which is the Margashirsha Mas, which is the December month, very cold, she is shivering, and Jaimini Rishi feels compassion for her, and he says, please come and stay in my hermitage, you know, in my this cottage, hut. Stay in my hut because, you know, you will be cold, you will die of cold. You are shivering already. So the lady says, no, I cannot come. You are a sadhu and I am a lady and I cannot come to your hut. And then Jaimini says, don't worry. I have no vikaras. I have no, you know, I have no attractions to anything of the world. Don't worry. You are safe. You come. So he takes her into the hut. He creates a fire, like a fireplace, and he tells the lady, you stay inside the hut, I will stay just outside the hut. And then he is sleeping outside the hut, and then he starts shivering because of the cold. He knocks on the door, he goes inside, and the lady is there sleeping near the fireplace, and he's saying, sorry, you know, I cannot sleep outside, it's too cold, so I will just sleep here. You sleep on that side, I am sleeping here. And he's sleeping. And then, but his mind gets disturbed. And then he wakes up and he tells the lady, actually, you know what? I think I would like to marry you. His mind is completely disturbed. And the lady says, yes, you can marry me, but I have one condition. You have to carry me and hold me, carry me around the fire 3 times. So he said, oh, that's it, simple. So he carries the lady. And he's walking around the fire. As he walks the first time, the lady says, Balavan Indriya Gramo. What does he say? Balavan Indriya Gramo Vidvamsam Napi Karshati. The learned people don't get bewildered. And then he's still bewildered. He does not still drop the lady. So he goes again. Again she says same thing. Balavan Indriya Gramo Vidvamsam Napi Karshati. Third time, same thing. And then he realizes, oh, how do you know this verse? And how do you know I changed it? And that time, the lady transforms into Vyasadev. And he says, see, I told you. So, you know, it is not like... One can say, oh, I am unaffected, nobody. Only one brahmachari is there. That is Krishna. He is eternal brahmachari. We see this in Gopi. What is the Upanishad? Which Upanishad speaks about Krishna as brahmachari? Gopala Tapani Upanishad, yes. Gopala Thapani Upanishad speaks about Krishna as Brahmachari. Eternal Brahmachari, not just Brahmachari, eternal Brahmachari. Yeah? Because no desire. He has no desire. So, even to give up attachment, even for a great sage like Jaimini, is so difficult. We have another episode of Shukdev Goswami who was in Shantaras. He told Vyasadeva, please tell me, what is the path of liberation? Vyasadeva said, path of liberation is you go gradually. Don't go on the fast train. Go on the slow coach. Go gradually. You are a brahmachari, become a grihastha, become a vanprastha, then become sannyasi, then give up everything of the world, and then you can become, you know, you can achieve the final goal. So he is not happy, Shukdev Goswami. So he says, I'm not happy. So to inspire him, Vyasadeva says, you need a guru. You need to have a guru. Everyone needs to have a guru. A living guru. And he says, you go to King Janaka. King Janaka is a great personality who has realized, he's self-realized. He has no attachment to this world. You go. And he will give you diksha and he will guide you on your path. This is Shukdev Goswami. Did you all know Shukdev Goswami's spiritual master is Janak Maharaj? Janak Maharaj. This is mentioned in Mahabharata. So, he goes to Mithila. Mithila is the city of Maharaj Janak. And he is there in Mithila. And when he is entering Mithila, the guards stop him. And when the guards stop him, it is mentioned the guards stop him for 7 days and 7 nights. The guards ask him, okay, you just wait here. We'll let the king know that some Brahmin is here, some sage is here. And Shukdev Goswami is very, very, you know, he's a kinchana. He's got nothing, no possessions. He has only got one danda and he has got a water pot, kamandalu. Water and danda, that's it. So nothing, no possessions. So he's standing there. He makes him stand for 7 days before he enters. And when he enters, Janak Maharaj does not see him directly. Janak Maharaj first tells him, not Janak Maharaj himself, but he tells the servants, you take him to the place where the courtesans are there and they are dancing, the women are there, they are dancing, the musicians are playing music, and there's a lot of entertainment. You take him to the entertainment hall. So he's taken to the entertainment hall. He's still the same person. He is not affected by anything. So when he was seemingly not treated properly by being made to stand for 7 days, 7 nights, or when he was being entertained, he's still the same. This is Shukdev Goswami. Yeah? And then Shukdev Goswami goes and finally he meets Janak Maharaj in the courtyard of, in the royal gardens actually, he meets Janak Maharaj. So Janak Maharaj is sitting, Shukdev Goswami is sitting. He's saying, please advise me, what is the goal of life? So Janak Maharaj says, before I advise you the goal of life, I would like to ask you for Dakshina. Generally, Guru Dakshina is afterwards, right? Guru Dakshina is not before giving the knowledge. But Janak Maharaj says, you give me Dakshina first. Why? Because once you realize the goal of life, you will not stay here. You will leave immediately. So you better give me my Dakshina first. Then Janak Maharaj has already schemed. So when Shukdev Goswami had gone to the entertainment hall, he had left his danda and kamandalu, his water pot, in the entertainment hall. Then he goes to Janak Maharaj. Janak Maharaj is sitting there. And one soldier comes, or one, you know, man of the court comes and he tells Janak Maharaj this. You listen carefully. He says, Janak Maharaj, there is a great fire in your army quarters. Your entire army is being burnt to ashes. What should a king do if he sees that his army is being burned? He should immediately run and, you know, put out the fire to protect them. But Janak Maharaj, he tells the person, the informer, the person who brings the news, he tells him, oh, that is the will of the Lord. It's okay. And this guy goes away, this person goes away. And so now this Shukdev Goswami is thinking, maybe he is not so attached. He is a big king, but maybe he is not so attached to his army. But I'm sure he is attached to the city. I'm sure he is attached to his palace, to his wealth. Yeah, he is not as detached as I am, Shukdev Goswami is thinking. I've got nothing, no possessions. Yeah, and then the person comes again. The person who brought the news first time, he comes again, he says, Janak Maharaj, sorry to disturb you. Your entire city of Mithila is burning. The whole kingdom is burning now. Janak Maharaj says, oh, thank you for the information. Thank you for the news. He says, maybe that is the will of the Lord. Shukdev Goswami thinks, oh, he's not attached to his city also? I'm sure he's attached to his palace because all his money is in the palace. All his treasure is in the palace. So he doesn't care. He can build another city. He can get another army. Then the man comes. And what does he say? He says, your palace is on fire. And as soon as the person says that, Shukdev Goswami immediately jumps up and tries to run to the palace to rescue his Kamandalu and his Danda. And Janak Maharaj holds him. Hang on a second. You wait here. He said, you see, I don't have any attachment to my palace, but you have attachment to your Danda and Kamandalu, which is actually of no value in, you know, monetary terms. Yeah? So Shukdev Goswami realizes. And there is a beautiful verse which is quoted many times in many scriptures. In the Shanti Parva of Mahabharata also, that verse is quoted. See, this Janak Maharaj exhibited this shamata, which we were talking about. Yeah, being completely indifferent to the world. That is the quality of a devotee. He is attached to Krishna and is indifferent to the world. So, the verse, and I'll end with that verse, the verse from Mahabharata Shanti Parva, which is quoted even by Bhima. Yeah? The verse goes like this. Anantam bata me vittam. Anantam, immeasurable bata. Oh my God. Me vittam, my wealth. Janak Maharaj is saying to Shukdev Goswami, what is he saying? He's saying, my wealth is immeasurable. Anantam bata me vittam, yasya me nasti kinchana. I have immeasurable wealth, but yasya me nasti kinchana, but nothing is mine. He's saying, I have immeasurable wealth, but nothing is mine. Mithilayam pradeeptayam, which means, the whole Mithila is burning. But, name daihati kinchana. But I am not being burnt. He says, these words are very often quoted. Mithilayam pradeeptayam. My entire Mithila is burning. But he says, name dahati kinchana. But I am not being burnt. See the detachment. Yeah? Beautiful verse, Janak Maharaj quotes. And this is quoted by Yudhishthir Maharaj, Bhima, Krishna quotes, some Puranas also this verse appears. Even Janak Maharaj is also glorified in Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Correct? We have glorification of Maharaj Janak in the Bhagavad Gita also. So this is the quality of... So this is how Shantarasa was, or the quality of Shamata was taught by Janaka Maharaj to Sukadeva Goswami, who later on, by hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, developed the Shantaras. Okay, we will stop here. Any questions? I have time for one question, maybe? Yes.
Thank you, Kartik Chandrapur. Wonderful class. Thank you for that, for the whole class, but specifically the last part you mentioned about Janak Maharaj and how detached he was. Because we're reading through the Mahabharata at the moment, Shantipava, and it's the part where Yudhisthira Maharaj is lamenting at the loss of life, etc., at the battle of Kurukshetra, and he's not inclined to become the king. And so everyone's trying to persuade him to actually do his duty. And he's giving so many arguments of why he shouldn't and why he should go to the forest. And one of the examples that they give, who gives it escapes me now, but one story is told of how Janak Maharaj wanted to renounce the kingdom. And his wife persuades him not to. So that just kind of put everything in place. Because when I read that story, I was a bit doubtful. Janak Maharaj, he's a king, he's a great king. But he actually wanted to renounce his kingdom.
Yes.
And he gives all these reasons. Then his wife gives him brilliant reasons why he should not become like an urchin searching for food on the floor when he has a duty to actually take care of his praja and his kingdom. So then he changes his mind and does his duty. Right, thank you.
Just thank you for sharing.
That just put everything in place. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Very nice. Thank you. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Samavet Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. Gaur Premanandi Hari Hari Bhav. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Hare Krishna. Thank you. Kartik Chandra Prabhu. Very educational class. Very nice, thank you so much. Okay, so we have some scores from yesterday. Radha's Boutique, 15 books distributed, 335 Lakshmi points. Govinda's Restaurant, 354 transactions for 3,416 Lakshmi points. And Closet Krishna, two small books, 21 medium books, 383 Lakshmi points. So it's a big day all around, especially on book distribution as well. So yesterday was a Maha Harinam Sankirtan Yagya day. There were several Harinams going out for many hours. It was a very amazing, ecstatic day. And so we have some nice book distribution score, starting with... Oh, wait, this isn't right. No, these are for the whole week. Oh dear. Okay, well, I'll read these scores out. So, Prananath Prabhu, 20 Lakshmi, 12 medium books, 1 Maha Big for 8 book points. Rasika Mangaladas, 15 Lakshmi, 11 small, 16 medium, 1 big for 11.75 book points. Bhakta Dimitri, 31 Lakshmi, 29 medium books for 14.5 book points. Jaitra Das, 120 Lakshmi, 19 big, 8 Maha big for 35 book points. Bhakta Sanjeev, 102 Lakshmi, 7 small, 73 medium, 4 Maha big for 46 book points. Jainitai Das, 151 Lakshmi, 32 Maha big books for 64 book points. Sachi Kumar Nimai Das, 148 Lakshmi, 100 small books, 100 medium books, 75 book points. Bhava Bhakti's mentee group, 172 Lakshmi, 1 small book, 119 medium books, 8 Maha big for 75 book points. Back to Vayu, this is over 8 days. 614 Lakshmi, 384 medium books, 21 big, 29 Maha big for 271 book points. Bhakta Sami, this is over 3 days. 801 Lakshmi, 447 medium books, 77 Mahabhi. These seem to be, I don't know why. Anyway, this seems to be the month so far, anyway, because this is the only score I have, that's why I'm reading it. Back to Rajesh, 5 days, 1,213 Lakshmi, 19 small, 473 medium, 176 maha big for 593 book points. And Nam Sankirtan Das, 1,311 Lakshmi, 349 medium, 18 big, 221 maha big for 634 book points. Srila Prabhupada's Transcendental Book Distribution Ki Jai. So we'll say the prayer before serving up prasadam. But before we do that, could we have some volunteers please to help serve prasadam this morning? Thank you. And anyone could volunteer to please clean the temple room after with prasadam. Okay, great. Thank you very much. Dear Sri Sri Radha Vandanishvara, Jagannath Baladev and Subhadra Maharani, Sri Sri Gauranathai and Giri Govardhan, we offer our most respectful obeisances unto you. In a mood of deep gratitude and appreciation, we request your causeless mercy upon us. For your pleasure, if you so desire, we wish to erect a holy place of your transcendental pastimes that will attract unlimited souls to your service and fulfill the vision of your pure devotee Srila Prabhupada for London. Please enable us to cooperate together in order to satisfy you in this way. We, your surrendered servants, humbly beg. New temple for Radhalandanishvara Ki Jai. Okay, please, all hands to the prasadam chain. Hare Krishna.